Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes.
Ground at all. springing up from this old ground. Out of chaos, life is being found in you. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of the dust. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us.
You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of the dust. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us.
Good morning, everybody. I'm so glad that you're able to join us today for our last week of goals. I just wanted to let you know I've been praying for you as we've been going through this series. I've been praying that not only will you set God-sized goals, but that you would know and love Jesus more every day. Having a stronger relationship with Him is the best goal you can have, not just this year, but for your whole life. So before we get started, let's go ahead and pray. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you that you want to take us to amazing places. We know that no eye has seen nor ear has heard what you have planned for those who love you. And so I just thank you that we can set God-sized goals that can impact the world and change our lives so we can love you more and love those around us better. Please help us today as we finish the story of Nehemiah to learn more about God-sized goals, and may we have God-sized goals this year. And it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so the first week we talked about how big difficulties can inspire God-sized goals. We learned that the Jewish people in Jerusalem had big problems because their walls were destroyed. Nehemiah saw this big difficulty, and it prompted him to act. And that week, I asked you to write down a GOAT, a greatest of all time goal that you have for this year. And I wrote down a few goals. And I've actually been able to keep up with them. I've been working out every day. I've been, you know, reading the Bible and praying every day. I've been loving God and loving my neighbors more every day. But I want to ask you, how are your goals going? How are you doing with those goals that you set? Last week, Pastor Jacob shared how we are all designed for God-sized goals. One part of his sermon that I really loved was when he shared his testimony about having a plan. He was able to get into the military because he followed this plan. But then he actually failed at reaching one of his goals of being an officer because he didn't have a plan for that. And he wasn't successful because he didn't have a plan. That's so important to remember. And I'm not saying that to make fun of Pastor Jacob. Obviously, God's plans were better. And maybe he wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him not being an officer. So God had better plans for him. But I want you to think about what you want to do when you get older. If you don't have a plan of how to get there, you probably won't get there. And that means you'll probably be just stuck at home doing whatever you're doing now all day, every day, which for a lot of you is maybe playing video games. The goals that you have for this year and for the rest of your life, you won't get there if you don't have a plan. Make a plan with God's help. And I am so excited for this last week of our sermon series on goals. It's going to be epic. If only we could meet in person, we'd have a few games and prizes. But hopefully things will open up soon so we can meet in person. But 2 weeks ago, we started this series by talking about New Year's resolutions. And did you know that after 2 weeks, most people have already given up on their New Year's resolutions? By the end of January, fewer than 25% of people are still committed to their goals. That means only one out of every four people that committed to making changes and following goals are still committed. That's crazy. That's because achieving our goals is hard work. Even when we make detailed plans and have the best intentions, it takes strength, commitment, and perseverance to follow through. And I don't know what your goals are right now. Maybe they're spiritual goals, physical goals, mental goals, relational goals. Maybe they're even God-sized goals. Whatever goals you have right now, I've got some good news and some bad news. The bad news is, if you haven't already, you're going to experience opposition and frustration and a lack of motivation on your way to achieving your goals. The good news is, there's hope when your goals are too much to handle on your own. When things get difficult and you feel weak or discouraged, how do you keep pursuing your goals, and how do you finish strong? Let's see what the story of Nehemiah has to show us. And if you weren't here last week, let's see if we can work together to get you up to speed. It all started with the city of Jerusalem, the home of the Jewish people long ago. The city of Jerusalem was destroyed by an army, and God promised the Jewish people that they would one day return to Jerusalem. Once he arrived in Jerusalem, Nehemiah got to work. And we won't read Nehemiah 3. It basically just talks about the tons and tons of people that he got living in Jerusalem to work together and repair the city walls. The incredible thing I see in this chapter is that there were so many people involved. This wasn't a project Nehemiah could have done on his own. This was a team effort. And the Jewish people slowly began rebuilding Jerusalem. And although people were living in Jerusalem, Nehemiah learned the walls were falling down. Nehemiah wanted to repair the walls to honor God and protect his people. For months, Nehemiah prayed and he planned and he prepared. Nehemiah asked the king to let him repair the walls. The king said yes. So Nehemiah recruited a team to help. But not everyone was excited about this idea. We're going to start reading in Nehemiah 4, verse 1. So let's direct our attention to the slide. So it says, Sanballat was very angry when he learned that we were rebuilding the wall. This is Nehemiah talking. He flew into a rage and mocked the Jews, saying in front of his friends and the Samaritan army officers, "What does this bunch of poor, feeble Jews think they're doing? Do they think they can build the wall in a single day by just offering a few sacrifices? Do they actually think they can make something of stones from a rubbish heap and charred ones at that?" Tobiah the Ammonite, who was standing beside him, remarked, "That stone wall would collapse if even a fox walked along the top of it." So we'll stop there for a second and talk about these bullies here. These guys, they called them weak. They mocked the quality of their work. They mocked their pain, mocked their beliefs. They tried to crush their hope. Bullying is actually a sign of weakness by the bully. The bully is often insecure and making fun of someone, and it makes them feel better for some reason. So I want you to try to treat them with compassion. I hope we can treat the bullies in our youth group and at Crosspoint Church with love and grace and compassion. And even though Nehemiah and his team were being obedient to God, they still had to deal with haters. And we sometimes have to deal with haters too. I'll tell you a story of a hater that I used to have in my life. But let's continue reading in verse 4. So Nehemiah said, "Then I prayed, 'Hear us, our God, for we are being mocked. May their scoffing fall back on their own heads, and may they themselves become captives in a foreign land. Do not ignore their guilt. Do not blot out their sins, for they have provoked you to anger here in front of the builders.'" At last, in verse 6 it says, "At last the wall was completed to half its height around the entire city, for the people had worked with enthusiasm." And I want to stop right there. There's so much that we could talk about here. But here's what I notice. Nehemiah didn't get distracted. He didn't fight with these guys, these bullies. He didn't add to their drama. He didn't even respond. Nehemiah instead took it to God. He asked God to hear his prayers and to make it right. And he wasn't afraid to be honest with God about what he was feeling. He wanted those guys to be punished. And Nehemiah kept going. He and his team kept building no matter what those guys, those bullies, had to say. They rebuilt the wall to half of its original height, and everyone poured their hearts into it. Now that's amazing. And now it says, and we're going to continue reading, "When Salabat, Tobiah, the Arabs, and the Ammonites, and the people of Ashdod heard that the gaps in the walls were being closed, they angrily plotted to attack Jerusalem and cause trouble. The Jews prayed to God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat." And Nehemiah faced further problems. The builders started complaining. They were exhausted, and the task was too much for them. Others warned Nehemiah 10 times that their enemies were planning to end the project. And Nehemiah stationed armed men with swords, spears, and bows in the gaps in the walls. A trumpeter stood by Nehemiah, ready to sound the alarm. "Don't be afraid of them," Nehemiah urged. "Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome, and will fight for you all." And so from that point on, half the men did the work, while the other half stood guard with swords, spears, bows, and armor. Those who were building also carried weapons. Work continued from dawn until sunset, as Nehemiah reminded them, "Our God will fight for us." And so after so much opposition, we'll stop reading right there. After so much opposition, the strength of Nehemiah's team was giving out. Those bullies were relentless, but Nehemiah was committed and strategic. Nehemiah took it to God again. He'd been in constant communication with God since the very beginning, and this moment was no different. And I noticed that, man, when I am in constant communication with God, there's nothing that can make me sad. There's nothing that can stand in my way and make me have bad days. And also, something else Nehemiah did is he prioritized rest. He knew he and his team needed rest if they were going to have the strength to keep going. So he found a way for them to work in shifts. They took turns. Nehemiah chose community. Nehemiah's team committed to protecting and supporting each other for as long as their opposition lasted. And Nehemiah kept going again. Their job was a little more difficult than it had been in the beginning, but Nehemiah never stopped. And he kept moving forward, adjusting his plan and getting creative in order to continue their work. And I wish I could tell you that Nehemiah's opposition ended there, but it didn't. He faced even more obstacles in chapters 5 and 6, both from his enemies and from his fellow Jewish people. And believe it or not, at one point, Nehemiah even received a series of terrifying letters and death threats. These men did not want Nehemiah to finish this wall. But watch how Nehemiah reacts. It says, and we're going to continue reading in Nehemiah verse 6 and 9. It says, "For they all wanted to frighten us, thinking their hands will drop from their work and it will not be done. But now, O God, strengthen my hands." Strengthen my hands, Nehemiah prayed. And that's where we'll stop reading. We just read one verse there. He could have asked God to do anything, but he simply asked God for strength to finish the work. Do you think they were able to complete the wall? Whenever you ask God for help, you know, if you ask him in faith, then usually he will always come through. But the answer to the question is yes, they were able to complete the wall. In Nehemiah 6:15, it says, 52 days after rebuilding started, the project was finished. Those who had opposed the project were afraid because they knew that this work had been done with the help of God. Man, wow. Did they have to overcome some crazy adversity and bullies to build this wall? It's a pretty awesome story. You know, I want to share a story of how I had to overcome adversity and bullies in my life. And no, this picture right here is not a picture of a bully. This is a picture of one of my best friends who helped me overcome that bully in my life. And I've shared this story a few times, but it's just such a good story. So at the old school I used to work at, there was this teacher who did not like me, and she was truly a bully. You can ask almost any teacher at the school. She always tried to make people mad. She always tried to get people in trouble. And it's just because of who she was. She was just a bully. But I remember I was going through a really, really difficult time with her. And I was actually kind of scared that maybe I would get fired because of her, because she was actually trying to get me fired. But thankfully, and I actually had this plan. I was going to make her look bad in front of the principal. I was going to call her out, call her names, use verses to attack her. But you know, my friend was really there for me during that time. Not only did he comfort me, but he also challenged me. And he said, "Caleb, don't do that. Don't attack her. Show her love and grace. She's probably been through a lot in her life, and she's a bully for a reason. And you attacking her will only make things worse. Just trust God, pray, and show her love and compassion." So thankfully, due to my friend, Willie, man, he's such an awesome guy, I miss that guy, I was able to overcome that adversity. I was able to not act out in fear and pain and attack her back, but I was able to show her love and grace. And I was even able to thank her for helping me to be a better person. And Willie was there to pray for me on that same morning that I had a meeting with her and my principal. And of course, I didn't get fired because what she was attacking me for was really stupid and ridiculous and didn't make sense at all. And I can maybe tell you about that another time. But thankfully, through God's help and with Willie, my brother, standing by my side, I was able to have victory. They were able to give me strength. You know, hundreds of years after Nehemiah lived, There was another man with a God-sized goal, and this goal was to spread the good news of Jesus to the whole world. And I'm sure most of you know this man. His name is Paul, and he was one of the leaders of the early church. At some point during Paul's ministry, he wrote a letter to a young man named Timothy, who he was mentoring to encourage him. And in this letter, it says in 2 Timothy 1:7, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-control." And I'd encourage you to memorize this verse. It's such a powerful and encouraging verse, because we all go through difficulties and trials. We all have fears in our lives. But we all know what it's like to face these obstacles. And this is never more true than when we're chasing God-sized goals. Although God never promises the process will be easy, here's what we are promised: that we don't need to be afraid, that God's Spirit will be with us, and that God will give us strength. The King of the universe, the one who conquered the grave, who did miracles and healed the blind, the sick, and the lame, he will give us strength. And along with strength, Paul mentioned love and self-control too. When God gives us God-sized goals, the challenges and opposition we face can be a gift. The resistance helps us to get stronger. When we face trials, those trials will usually make us stronger and better. Just like Nehemiah planned to experience opposition, we should expect to face difficulties when we're pursuing God-sized goals. But here's the good news. I promise, no matter what the world throws at us, we don't have to be afraid. God does not give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. We can know for sure that God gives us strength to pursue God-sized goals. We do not have to do it alone. God will give you the strength to pursue God-sized goals as long as you ask him. And don't just ask him one time. Keep asking him. Keep chasing after him. And sometimes it seems like our challenges become the most difficult just before we cross the finish line. That was certainly true for Derek Redmond. He was a runner who competed in the 1992 Olympics. And Derek planned, he prepared, and he trained hard. But 250 meters away from the finish line, something terrible happened. His hamstring tore. And let's watch this video, this inspiring video of Derek Redmond and how he was able to finish.
Tom Hammond and Craig Massback back at Olympic Stadium in Barcelona, coming up to the men's 400 meter semifinals. Here are the lane assignments. Steve Lewis in lane three, top four to Wednesday's final. Steve Lewis in lane three. Roberto Hernandez out quickly in four. Now down the backstretch.
Ismael on the left of the screen is running very, very quickly. And inside of Lewis, Sunday Bada of Nigeria.
And Derek Redmond of Great Britain has pulled up with an injury. Redmond is out.
Derek Redmond, the British record holder and an important member of that British 4x400 meter relay team, as he doesn't want anybody to help him.
And it'll be Lewis to win in 44.50.
Look at this. He's going to try to finish his semifinal race. The British have a certain tradition of running, which you have to respect.
A bizarre finish to this first semifinal in the men's 400 meters. Derek Redmond of Great Britain pulled up with an injury halfway down the back stretch. He's fighting off those trying to help him to finish the race in his lane. And now the pain too much. swelling throughout Olympic Stadium as Redmond, with assistance this time, approaches the finish line he had wanted so desperately to reach. That is the Olympic spirit.
Man, that was such an amazing video. I love it. That's so powerful of his dad coming alongside him and helping him across the finish line. That video makes me tear up every time. You see, at some point, we're going to face opposition that threatens to keep us from achieving our goals. And that opposition can feel overwhelming, especially if you're alone. But when you're following Jesus and chasing a God-sized goal, you are never alone. God is with you, and God gives you the strength, and God will even carry you when you can't keep going on your own. That's why I love this video, because it's kind of a picture of what God does with us. He's always there with us and walking alongside us and helping us carry our burdens and facing opposition. So what's one of your goals? Are you thinking of something right now? If you're not sure what you think about God or God-sized goals right now, that's okay. What I'm going to share with you applies to any kind of opposition, discouragement, or difficulty you might face. And if you're not sure you've found a God-sized goal for yourself yet, that's okay too. Sometimes it takes time. Your God-sized goal doesn't need to be about changing the whole world. It might be as simple and powerful. It might be as simple and powerful as making a difference for Jesus in your school or your family or your circle of friends. Maybe you need to work on honoring your parents and obeying them when they ask you to do things. And not just obeying them, but obeying them with the right attitude. Maybe you need to work on being a better brother or sister to your sibling that you have such a hard time loving. Because you know Jesus wants to help you with that. If you think you might have a God-sized goal in your heart, that's great, but it can be very simple. But keep listening, because you're bound to face some opposition to that goal eventually. A few moments ago, we saw how Nehemiah handled opposition. Now, what if we took those same tactics that Nehemiah used and we applied them to our goals? Do you have one of your goals in mind? Is there something that you want to do or become or change, but you're facing opposition? Keep your goal in mind as we think about these five things together, or these six things together, that can help us achieve this goal. When you need strength, first, you need to take it to God. Nehemiah was in constant communication with God, and we should be in constant communication with God. But this was especially true when he was facing opposition. When you're struggling with the goals God has called you to pursue, what would it look like for you to talk to God more regularly, to come to him and bring your burdens to him? What would you ask for? What would you say? In John 15:5, it says that Jesus tells us that apart from him, we can do nothing. We must take our struggles to God. The next thing we can do is choose community. God gives us strength through the Holy Spirit, but God also gives us strength through community. And I shared with you a few minutes ago about my friend Willie. If my friend was not there with me, I probably would have made a fool out of myself, and I would not have handled that situation in the way God wanted me to handle it. You know, we weren't designed to pursue God-sized goals alone. We need each other. So when you're facing opposition and losing strength, what would it look like for you to lean on your community, to ask them for help, to ask them for wisdom, for prayer? Are you surrounded by people that you trust in your life who can help you achieve your God-sized goals? Maybe if not, maybe you should start building that community right now. Maybe you should start asking God for that community, for friends that can help you, for leaders that can help you. The next thing is we need rest. Nehemiah asked God for strength to keep going, but he knew he and the rest of his community needed to rest too. We weren't designed to hustle forever. So what would it look like for you to make rest a priority, especially on the Sabbath, spending time with God, when you're feeling overwhelmed, weak, or tired? What helps you feel rested and renewed so you can keep going? Is it sleep? Is it time with friends? Is it time by yourself? Time away from the internet and your devices? I know this can be a huge distraction in our life, and most of us can never find rest because we get so addicted to our phones and our computers. We must not get addicted to these things. These things will not give us true joy and rest. But it's okay to play games every once in a while. I'm not condemning gaming. I play games too. The next thing is we cannot get distracted. Don't get distracted. When you're following God, not everyone will like it or support your God-sized goals. And that's okay. It's not your job to please everyone. Your job is to please God and to stay close to people who want what's best for you, who love God with you. So what does this look like for you? Whose voices do you need to learn to ignore? And whose voices do you need to learn to listen to? The next thing we need to do is to keep going. Take a deep breath in. Now slowly breathe out. If you can feel that breath, it means you're still here and you have another chance to keep going. Opposition will come. Things will get difficult. But if you know Jesus, you've got the Spirit of God inside you, filling you with strength, power, love, and self-control. And with God, you can keep going. And the last thing, the most important thing that I want to leave with you is you need to keep your eyes on Jesus. He is the goal and prize that far outweighs anything you can earn in this life. The prize that prize that you can have in him, no one and nothing can take away from you. Get to know Jesus by reading the Bible and talking with him every day. He loves you so much. He died and rose from the dead so you can have a relationship with him. And no one can force you to do that. I can't force you to do that. Your parents can't force you to do that. You must make that choice, and you must do that in order to experience him. A lot of people complain about, like, oh, I never experienced God. I never hear from him. God doesn't love me. But how much have you tried to pursue him? How much time have you invested in that most important relationship that you can have on this earth? Most people are too lazy to chase after God, but he always chases after us, and he is always ready for us to come to him. So I want to encourage you to keep your eyes on Jesus. And that life won't always be perfect. You won't always be able to chase after him the way you're supposed to, because you're human and I'm human. But the thing is, we need to try. We need to put all our effort and all our energy into the thing that matters the most, and that is getting to know our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, our best friend, our perfect Father, the only one who can help us with the trials in our lives. So what's one goal that you're working on right now that requires God-sized strength? Do you have it in your mind? Now, do you believe, like really believe, that God can help you to reach that goal? If your goal honors God or was given to you by God, then yes, God can help you. He can help you see it through, no matter what comes. So take it from Nehemiah, take it from Paul and Timothy, and from me, God gives us strength to pursue God-sized goals. Let's go ahead and pray. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for giving us a purpose in this life. We know that so many people in this world are hopeless, and they feel lost and afraid and fearful and depressed and anxious. But we know that when we have you by our side, we have a living hope. We have a future that is bright and that is amazing. If we would only set God-sized goals, if we would only chase after you and get a stronger relationship with you, I just pray for every student here that's listening that they would fall in love with you this year, that they would see you as the greatest goal and greatest prize, and that you are better than anything and anyone this world has to offer, and that we would make you our ultimate goal and aim. And may you help us with the different oppositions and trials and struggles that we face. May we lean on you for strength. and keep our eyes on you. Thank you so much for this time. Bless the rest of our week and help us to have the best year ever, because we set God-sized goals and we made it a point to get to know you, to love you, so that we can love others more. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thank you so much for joining. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
From high to heaven to darkest night, the mission of the Father's heart upon your mind, nothing would stop you. Beneath the burden, you felt the weight. You held the tension of the price you have to pay. Nothing would stop you. Bless the one who reigns forever. Bless the one who ransomed me. From death to life there is no other. Bless the only risen King. The Lamb of glory poured out for us at Calvary, your body broken on the cross. Nothing would stop you. The lion's story through gates of hell defeated death, and then you came back from the dead. Nothing would stop you. Nothing could stop. Bless the one who reigns forever. Bless the one who ransomed me. From death to life there is no other. Bless the only risen King.
From death to